back to the Cross Border Interview Podcast. My name is Christopher Brown, your host, and today we are sitting down with our very first candidate from the ward we actually are residing in, Ward 10. And he's giving us the thumbs up. He came in, sat down in studio. Tony Dinh, the candidate for Ward 10. Thank you so much for doing this, Tony. Greatly appreciate it.
Thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here. As I mentioned earlier, I grew up in Whitehorn, so this is like home to me here.
Awesome. As if you've listened to the show before, you probably know the exact first question that I'm going to ask you, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Where's your sense of duty to serve come from?
Sense of duty to serve. Yeah, that's a good question. So, you know, like my family, they immigrated here from a war-torn country, Vietnam. And my parents were really fortunate that they can make it here because I know my family back at home, they, you know, there's not a lot of opportunity. Life is just how it is there. And so my parents are really fortunate that we're here. And they always raised me that we're here for a future for you guys, for my siblings. You know, my two older brothers, my older sister, I'm the youngest. And so I was always raised that, you know, we're here for you guys, for a future for you guys. And so, you know, just with that sentiment, I'm like, okay, so you want a future for us. And, you know, now that I've grown up, you know, I'm a man now, I just had a daughter, she's turning 2. And it's about community for me now. And, you know, I was raised that, you know, we're an opportunity, and I feel that I'm very fortunate. And now I can actually make an impact to the community. And, you know, a lot of it is, you know, just to show my daughter that, you know, who her father is. Make it a good example. And really, Northeast Calgary has been really, you know, very generous to us. A lot of, you know, a lot of Vietnamese people, a lot of very ethnic, multicultural, and really accepting. And so being born and raised in Northeast Calgary, Whitehorn specifically, and then we moved to Monterey Park, I see there's a sense of, you know, where I'm at right now is a sense of service. And, you know, I wanted to inspire people to take an active role in the democratic process. And it's just what enlivens me right now.
So I got to ask the question to follow up on that. You can give back in many different ways. You can do nonprofit organizations. You can give back by volunteering your time and service, but you've chosen the political route. Before I ask the first question, I'm going to ask this sort of small question. Was your family political?
Not at all. Not at all. There was nothing indicating that I would go into politics.
So the question then has to be, why get involved now? What in 2021 made you think to yourself, I know you talked about your daughter, but I want to know, what is it about Ward 10 right now, the city of Calgary, that you says, you know what, my voice is needed at that council chamber because I want to make sure this is done or this is done?
Yeah, totally. You know, when you look at Calgary and then you look at Ward 10 specifically, a lot of people feel that nothing changes in Ward 10. It's the status quo. And I grew up here, and you know, the communities were newer when I lived here, and I watched them, you know, over a couple of decades, it tended to decay. And really, it needs, Ward 10 needs the attention. It needs it's a fair share to have it, you know, be taken care of. And now that our city council retired, we have an opportunity for some strong young leadership right now. And right now it's just a really pivotal place in, you know, Calgary's history, with a lot of shakeup in city council. And so I just seen that, you know, I looked at what I'm doing already, and I'm really impacting communities. We're revitalizing streets. And so we're already contributing to people through quality architecture and design. And I just looked, I have a legitimate resume. I have a credible resume, and it's already what I'm doing. And now I can really serve people on a bigger platform as city councillor.
We are in a very unique time. Like you said, we've had the same incumbent Ward 10 councillor for some time. He resigned early last year. This is a vacant seat. We have a very diverse amount of people running for this ward. What makes you stand out? Let's talk about that resume that you were just talking about. And I'm looking at your brochure that you've brought in. It says, I want to talk about these 6 things that you've put on there. Accountable, builder, entrepreneur, collaborator, inspirational, problem solver, and visionary. What are those six words, keywords, or seven, because there's a few extra words there, but what are those 6 points, and why are they so important for Ward 10 right now to have someone with those key attributes?
Yeah, you bet. So these are principles, values that I have. And so what makes me stand out? Being born and raised, and I know like being born and raised in these communities is one thing. People connect that, like, oh, got it. You're here. You've been here for a long time. You understand the struggles that others have. But also having that cultural lens helps also because it's very multicultural. So I connect with many people on many different levels. And the thing is that I have a credible track record, a history. And so things I live by is being accountable. If you say something, follow through in your words. And that's really a big thing for me is keeping the integrity. And I believe we need transparency in City Hall. And
I want to pick up on that. Sorry, and I didn't don't want to interrupt you because I want you to lead the conversation. But you talk to people in Ward 10, my neighbors, my family members, and I think I have a semi pulse on the neighborhood that is this area. And the one thing that you hear from people in Ward 10 is integrity. We want someone who's actually going to stand up and actually listen to A, the us when we elect you, but B, don't bring the voice of City Hall to our ward, but bring the ward's voice to City Hall. How are you going to do that? How are you going to ensure that people are heard? Your integrity is one thing, but the integrity to actually do the job and represent the people is another. So how do you envision your integrity to be that voice at City Hall for the people of Ward 10?
Yeah, good question. So we spend a lot of time listening, talking to people, engaging them, allow them to be heard. A lot of people feel that they haven't been heard. They actually feel that there's a bit of resignation. They feel that even if they say something, nothing happens. And so what I say is that I represent the underrepresented, and that's the people that have felt a bit of, a little defeat, and they just want something to happen. They want something to change. They want someone to actually represent us and then actually make change. And right now I feel like we need some strong young leadership right now that it's like I said, I think sensitive to the cultures and still has the roots here. I have we grew up in an entrepreneurial business. My parents had a business, so I understand that. And my dad, he was a farmer in Vietnam. Our family's farmers. So I would say that I'm a hardworking businessman because that's how my dad raised me. Hard work, hard work. He worked two jobs all the time. So, a lot of the people here are hardworking and they're fortunate. They feel fortunate to be here, to be in Canada. And so, having that relatedness and people that have been here for a long time because I've been here my whole life. So just talking to them, engage them, and then actually, what do we want, and how can I be of service right now? And I feel like we have a blank slate that I can do whatever the community wants. I can get it done, basically.
So I want to talk about that because that brings up sort of a big line of questioning here is any candidate worth their dime is canvassing right now. They're trying to talk to as many people as possible before Election Day on October 20th, 2018, 20th,
18.
18th. There you go. Sorry. October 18th. Please, 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 please go out October 18th or advance vote, not October 20th. You'll miss the voting day.
There you go.
What are you hearing though? What are the people of Ward 10 telling you that needs to be done? Because you probably have a slate of ideas that you want to bring to council, but at the end of the day, you also have to listen to the people's voice. So, what are the people of Ward 10 telling you that needs to be changed or fixed at City Hall to better help them and move forward?
Right. So a lot of people are concerned with, there's a lot of drug use right here in Ward 10. So they are concerned about the streets, making sure they're safe. A lot of people are also concerned with their livelihood, jobs. I would say that's probably the number one is they want to get back to work. A lot of them entrepreneurs, but also they just want to get back to work. They want to provide, they want to get back to their livelihood. But you know, I think one of the biggest issues is also the mental health that people, you know, just not having that income, it wears on people, the sense of security. And I think really that's one of the things that we need to address is the mental health, which is the short term, which is the immediate. And what that really does is it deals with the long term. And so Ward 10, you know, we're a hardworking group, and we got hit by a pandemic and a COVID. And you know what? It's okay. You know, it happened, and we're going to deal with it, and then we're going to continue and move on with our lives and build back stronger.
I want to talk about COVID-19 for a second, because you brought it up, and before we go back to these topics that you've mentioned are what you're hearing at the door, but COVID-19 has shone a light into this city and people who are struggling the hardest. We are, hopefully, knock on wood, in the recovery stages of this. I know there's word that we are in the fourth wave, but I want to always have the bright side and say that we are in the recovery stages. How do you envision working with 14 other people to ensure everyone gets a fair shot at recovery from this pandemic? There are people who are losing their houses. There are people one paycheck away, and you talked about that, about mental health. One paycheck away from losing their house, losing their roof over their head, being out on the streets. How do you ensure that the city gives everyone a fair shot at recovery? And how do you envision doing that for such a diverse community, such a diverse ward like Ward 10?
Yeah, good question. So, you know, I would say that we need to have a business-friendly environment. We need to get the business back and going back at work. You know, small businesses, the heartbeat of the economy, and you know, getting people back to work, having a business friendly economy, even attracting talent, attracting tech, attracting more film that's already growing. These are all really diverse economies that we can grow. But really the main thing I think is, you know, getting people back to work and having a business friendly environment. And yeah.
But is there, because when I talk to my neighbors, and I'm just talking about my one neighbor that I've literally, every time I go out to take the garbage out, we have that morning, 8 o'clock in the morning conversation about how's everything going, how's that. And the one thing he talks about is taxes and services, because some people might find that for what we're paying, the services aren't there, or they can't tell you what type of services they're getting for their tax dollars. So how do you envision better communicating? Okay, yes, we all have to pay taxes. People are sometimes okay with paying taxes, as long as the services that are provided for those tax dollars are going to be used in an appropriate fashion. How do you envision telling people, okay, yes, we're going to potentially have a 0.1% increase or 0% increase, your service levels aren't going to be cut though.
Right. Yeah. And so what you're talking about is a lot of what your neighbors are saying. A lot of people in Ward 10, so most people, they don't mind paying the taxes.
Yeah.
As long as they get the services that are promised to them.
Exactly.
Right. And so that's fine. Obviously people don't like to increase their taxes, and I don't want to do that also. I wouldn't want that. I would actually propose a tax freeze. And so what I would say to the people is that you know, I get they want low taxes, and the thing is that if we look at it all over Canada, you know, we are just catching up to all the other major municipalities, that our taxes are actually just catching up. So we are actually, we've lived in a very low tax environment, and that's what the people like, and that's what they've spoken, and we're just catching up. So I think letting them know that, you know, you're not getting the sheet over pulled over your head.
Yeah.
We are catching up, but the people have talked, they want low taxes. So, you know, I would really encourage to keep them low, and let's get the spending in check.
You talked about drug use. Before I moved to this area, I'm relatively new, and if anyone's listened to the show, they know that I moved from northern Alberta to here almost 3 years ago. And the one thing I did before I moved here was I researched, because I think everyone should research before they move into a location. And I researched the neighborhood, the crime statistics, because I wanted to know if I was moving into a safe neighborhood. And it's relatively safe. Like, we don't have that much crime in the street. Yes, okay, we have the occasional one or two off, but it's not bad. But the one thing I did notice was the drug use. The drug use in this ward, and in particular Ward 5, Ward 10, is quite high. We have gang issues in this area as well. How do we combat that to make people feel safe? Because while we try to feel safe, there's always that hesitation to look over your shoulder and say, okay, is something happening? Because you look at the news, and I'm not dissing the mainstream media here at all, but news story after news story is, hey, there was a gun shootout in this location, there was a stabbing in this location, and you look at it, it's usually Ward 5 or Ward 10. How do you change that narrative so people feel safe in their neighborhood and we combat drug use?
Yeah, that's a good question, and I think it's a multi-process step to deal with. I would say, number one, we got to deal with people and their mental health, but also dealing with the addictions, actually get them cured. I from what I hear, the system's not working. It's kind of like a revolving door. They kind of get in, and then they're kind of out in the same environment. And so it just keeps happening over. So the system's not right. It's not curing them. And so, I think from what people I've talked to, experts, they've said, the system needs work. So I think possibly allocating some resources towards getting people cured so that it's not, continually happening. Number two, what I've heard from what is really working, and it was working, and actually to say stopped that, but people, police officers on the bikes, and I heard that was a very effective program. It deterred a lot of people from, crime and less drug, usage and that type of activity, because there's actual people on the ground. And in a vehicle, a patrol car, I get it, they're patrolling, but if you're going 30, 40 kilometers, it's a little bit different than on a bike that's going maybe 10, 15, and you're spending a little bit more time on the streets, and people, you have more, I think you have a little more visibility on what's going on the streets. And it was a really effective program from what I've heard, and I would think that we could continue that, and that would actually help with people feeling safer. Because if something happened, they can get on a bike versus, the patrol car drives by and they didn't see behind them, right? And so there's just a little more visibility, and I think that would help have others, second guess doing crime or not, because there's someone that can, hop off bike and tackle them, or, deal with any sort of crime.
I want to talk about you as the next councillor for Ward 10. If you were elected, I guarantee you will not get, depending on how many candidates actually come out, let's say there's eight right now, you will not get eight votes. So guaranteed you're not going to get 100% of the vote on election day because you have other candidates running against you. How do you envision working for the all people and not just for the people who have voted for you?
So how would I work for all the people? I think it's, keeping in mind what's best for Ward 10, for the betterment of it. Like I said, I've been here for decades. So it's just interesting that, where I grew up, the home that we lived in, the parks that we lived in, there's different people there. There's new immigrants. And it's the same streets, it's the same parks, it's just the different people. And so I've watched that, the evolution of, the different people coming to the communities. And so really what's the best for the community, and what I've heard is a lot of it's the safety, a lot of it's, having some of the money reinvested back in our communities. The councilors previous, they did a good job with all the parks that we have, and some would like to see the enhanced park, so more benches, maybe shelter from, so gazebos or whatnot from sunshine or rain, so the people can really enjoy what we have existing. And another good point is actually a lot of people do, like I said, there is a lot of immigrants here, and they want to bring their families here. They want them to have a future also. And so they want some support in, you know, even though we're the most livable city in North America, that's the, you know, what we've gotten. It can be a challenge to integrate in these cities. You know, if you don't have family, or, you know, if you don't have family, it could be tough. And so a lot of that is the support there. I would say for Ward 10, that's a good chunk of what people want. But really, I think at the end of the day, it's, you know, safe streets and, you know, the betterment of the communities and the wards. And the communities, each community, they do want a little bit, something a little bit different. So it's just making sure that, you know, are they getting taken care of, because, you know, each community matters.
Any political observer of municipal government will tell you, you will be one vote on council. I think anyone who's running for council, if they say they're going to fix everything and they have a plan to fix everything, is kind of BSing you, because you are one vote on this council. And sometimes, and I've asked this to all the other candidates, sometimes your ward will have to go without, because you have to look at the betterment of the city. While you are there to represent Ward 10, you also have to have a look at the bigger picture, because you have to always be looking at the city of Calgary, but also focusing on your ward. How do you balance that? How do you say, I'm here to represent Ward 10, but at the same time, we need to also look at potential things in Ward 4, Ward 3, Ward 11, Ward 12, Ward 5 up north, Ward 9 to the south. And sometimes our ward will have to go without. How do you balance that? How do you balance that to say, I'm looking after Ward 10, but at the same time, I need to look after the city?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. So I would rely back on my experience. You know, I believe that we need some long-term equitable investments in Calgary. So infrastructure, you know, the Green Line. That's not exactly in Ward 10.
Yeah.
Right. But we need that. And that's for the betterment of the city, I'd say. We need sustainable infrastructure, equitable for everyone that's going to live in there. And that's, you know, that would be one of the, you know, one of the examples. You know, I believe in the event center. You know, we lived in a very young, vibrant city, exciting, you know, Calgary Flames, concerts, festivals, all those things like that people want. You know, we have a very young population. And so, you know, I think that, you know, keeping in mind of, you know, we are building our city. But I would still, you know, what does Ward 10 want? And I'm going to advocate for Ward 10. And like you said, it would be one vote out of 15.
Do you see yourself bringing forward ideas that you may not completely agree with? Because we have a very diverse community. I think you know that. And if you go down the street, you're going to hear about 10 different things from 10 different houses on what their top priority is. And sometimes you might get a, hey, I want my sidewalk fixed because it's broken. And at the end of the day, you have to go, well, it's not in the budget. We aren't looking at this area because there's other areas that are in worse shape. But because your residents have come to you and said, I want this fixed, you will have to advocate for them as well. So do you see yourself as a person who can say, yes, I want to advocate for all the issues that Ward 10 brings forward, but also I will say no when I have to, because budgetary concerns, budgetary issues, and at the end of the day, you have to be able to say no to people because not everything is going to be fixed right away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all right. So
I have asked this to everyone, because yeah, at the end of the day, a counselor's job is to advocate for their citizens, but not everything is going to get done. In a perfect world, it would, but sometimes you'll have to say no because it's not in the budget or it's not a priority at this time. There are other things that are taking priority. How do you envision working in that scenario?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I think talking to, you know, the individual or the group that's, you know, bringing it up and really address that. And, you know, if it's something that is immediate, okay, let's deal with it immediately, right? And if it's something that can wait, then let's have it wait. And some have maybe waited for a long time. But, you know, we do got to look at a budget. If they want to keep the taxes low and we got to keep our budget in check, then this is what you guys want, right? And this is what it looks like. Right. And it would take someone to be, you know, take the leadership and communicate and be like, listen, you know, it's not in the budget and I understand it's inconvenient, but, you know, we gotta work with our budget. And if it's immediate, then we should take care of it. If it's not, then you know I'm gonna need you to hang in for a little bit. I know it's frustrating, but listen, like you know, I hear you, and we're going to, you know, we're gonna find a solution.
And it goes back to one of your key attributes on your brochure here, which is the problem solver, right? Is the fourth one on the second row, second in, it says problem solver. You pride yourself on being a problem solver because if I'm assuming you wouldn't, if you would if you put it on your brochure. In your past, what problems have you solved in that type of situation where people have had to say, you have had to say to people, while we would love to do this, we can't right now because we're in a constraint or it's not a priority right now. I wanted some real life experience from you here.
I'm pressing. Yeah, oh
I'm
yeah.
throwing you on the loop here.
Beautiful. I love it. Okay, so, you know, problem solver. Yeah, I got that on my brochure here. And I would say I'm a solution oriented.
Okay.
I don't dwell on the problem. I'm not gonna, be, a victim or whatnot. You know, I do look at solutions and let's, be solution oriented, right? And so that's why I have problem solver. Now, I think, an example, here's an example, and hopefully this answers your question. You know, as a builder, I build houses, and I've built in Marteloup, I've built in Killarney, I've built in Renfrew, all these nice affluent communities, and the thing is that I've chosen to build in Albert Park, Radisson Heights, Forest Lawn areas where they need the most housing, or at least revitalized housing, because if people don't invest into communities, they tend to decay. And so there's a problem there because there's a stigma there, Forest Lawn, Albert Park, Radisson Heights. But the thing is, it's 10 minutes from downtown. And so not a lot of people are going there, And so I say I'm kind of the crazy guy that's doing it. But the thing is, it's not that crazy, because it's 10 minutes to downtown. And I went to high school there at Father Lacombe and Bishop McNally. And so I've been in these areas, and it's not that crazy, and it's 10 minutes away. So it's solving the problem where others are not necessarily wanting to go to, and give it a little bit of time, and it's gonna be the next. It's right beside Inglewood. And Inglewood's right beside East Village and Ramsey. So it's going outwards. It's just on the other side of Deerfoot. So I would say that would be solving a problem, because the thing is, people aren't offering diverse housing options, and they want to stay there, but they want to stay in the communities, but nobody's offering it, and they want to. They work by there, and they can afford to live in other places, but the 5-10 minute commute to work is invaluable, and so that would be solving a problem.
It would. Greatly appreciate it for answering that. I want you to put yourself on October 19th. Now, October 19th, you are the next councillor designate for Ward 10 in the city of Calgary. What is priority number one for you?
Priority number one would be, building trust again with Ward 10. A lot of people, they haven't they just they haven't felt trust in city council. So his number one is, building that trust, building the lines of communication again, and letting them know that we have a city councilor now, as we, right now we don't have one. And
Well, we kind of do.
right, yeah, I mean, we, yeah,
We have two
we have two,
technically.
technically, yeah, I guess we have two. Yeah, it would be building the trust again with the people, and then having, making sure the streets are safe, and then start advocating for Ward 10. Let's start getting investment back in Ward 10. Let's replenish our community, and start giving it some attention. And we're not gonna be, we're not gonna be left away anymore, left out. Look, we have someone, and I'm here to, fight for our community now.
As a builder, as a, I'm assuming an entrepreneur as well, you know that you have to put in metrics in place to ensure success. If you're building a project, you have to say metric one is get this done by this time, two done by this time, three done by this time. What are the metrics you're going to put in place for yourself to ensure you have a successful first 100 days in office, first year in office? Because we want, if I come back to you in a year time and say, let's sit down, you've been a year in office, let's talk about what you've accomplished. What are the things that you're going to be able to say, these are the metrics I've accomplished, and these are the things that I'm happy that Ward 10 now has?
Okay, so what I can see just here on the spot, I would open, make sure it's very clear what the community associations want. They're the ones that are in the community. They know the what people want, the demands, what's been pressing, what's the pressing matters that have not been dealt with, and what are we gonna do? What are we gonna work together in the next 100 days? What are we gonna get done so that people are trusting in you and me and the rest of the communities, and that they're gonna have their needs met, on a community government level. And what things have been promised, and how do we get these done?
I want to ask this question, and I want you to look at this camera right here because this is going to be edited to do this. Talk to the people of Ward 10 who are listening to this because I do have a lot of listeners in Ward 10. Why should you be the next councillor for Ward 10?
All right, well, Ward 10 constituents. So why should I be the next Ward 10 city councillor? Aside from being born and raised in the communities and understanding what people have dealt with, and the struggles and challenges that they've endured, I've been there with them. I grew up in these communities, in these neighborhoods, so I understand all that. And also the fact that I do have the cultural lens, sensitivity to understand also multi levels of understanding people, and I have a proven track record. I have a credible resume, and I'm a strong candidate for Ward 10. And I'm young, and I'm ready to fight for our community, and that's what we need, strong leadership. And as we build our city, as we build the Green Line, we build the event center, there's never been a better time to have the builder in City Council. And that's why they should vote for me October 18th.
Awesome. My last question here, though. In order to get to October 19th, in order to get to the first 100 days, you need to be elected. And I'm assuming, like every campaign that I've asked, you need volunteers, you need donors, you need people to help put up signs. How can people get involved? How can people reach out to you? And he wrote this down, ladies and gentlemen. He knew this question was coming. How can people get involved? How can people reach out to you and get more information? Because if I have not asked a question that they want asked, how can they do that?
Okay, all right, I'm ready for this. So my Instagram is Tony Dinh 403. So first name, last name, 403. So that's Tonydinh 403. And my website, tonydinh.ca. You can find my platform. You can find my vision. I actually have ideas, what I see for our communities. You can go to my Facebook page, vote him in, Tony Dinh. That's Facebook. And then Twitter, Tony Dinh 403. And yeah, I'm active on all the channels, and each channel we have, a little bit of different media, but that's all, ran by me and my team. And yeah, we'd love to have you be a part of making history. So we've never actually had a Vietnamese city councilor before, and so we're actually working towards making history for October 18th.
I want to ask that question because I did not know that. And I asked this to someone else who was all, would also be the first woman of color who would be on city council. What would it mean to you and to your family to for someone who came family who came to this country to be elected as the first Vietnamese person on city council?
It would be an honor to do that. My grandpa, he's in Vietnam. He would be really proud. I really just want to make my community happy. I want to make the people happy. I want to actually really serve and make a difference in the communities. And it would mean, really, I guess it would be making history. And I guess I'm just what I see is, like, a lot of the Vietnamese people have been really productive in our communities, and me, I would just be honored to represent the people and the communities, and it would just be really magical.
Awesome. I'm gonna sort of. I know Tony just listed off and named all his social media platforms, but I'm gonna make it a lot easier for everyone so you're not scribbling it down. For those who are tuning in, watching this live or watching this as it premieres, the links to Tony's Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and website will all be in the show notes. For those who are listening on the podcast and all the platforms, the links to his Instagram, website, Facebook, and Twitter will also be in the show notes. And please click on them. Get out. Engage with your local council candidates. But also, and I feel like I'm beating a dead horse here, but get out, educate yourself, and vote. Vote, 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 vote. I can't say it enough. This is the future of our city that we're talking about. And at the end of the day, we want to make sure we have the best people at City Hall representing us. Tony, thank you so much for doing this. Thank you so much for coming in, sitting down on this beautiful day. It's our first beautiful cold day, but thank you so much for doing this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you so much for having me, and thanks for doing this also.